Welcome back to War Thunder and welcome aboard the Matilda Mark II, which is a nowadays Soviet premium Chronicle reward tank. And you want to basically know if this tank is worth your effort slash your golden birds. Well, that is a difficult question because this is just rank 2 and it is a battle rating of 3.3, which is not very high. But I can tell you one thing, this tank gets results if you basically know how to drive a tank properly. Having said that, the Matilda Mark II in this state is kind of a hybrid and not really a completely new tank. Why is that? Well, the Matilda Mark II itself is very well known in the British tech tree at around about the same battle rating, if not the very exact same battle rating. And the gun behaves very similar to the L11 gun slash the gun on the 1941 T-34, which is the F-34 cannon. Especially the ammunition selection is the same, basically. And, you know, that is a 3.7 tank. This tank, well, has some good stats and some bad stats. And let's talk about the good stats. Well, you have a very good gun that can basically penetrate everything that there is at your battle rating and even above. And you have a decent armor layout. I will point out this in a moment. And the next thing is the bad parts. Well, first of all, 2 degrees of gun depression. That's awful. The mobility is outright bad. The horsepower to ton ratio is really, really bad. The reverse speed is bad. The survivability after penetration is not the best, just for crew members. Also, having said that, you know, yeah, things like that happen. If you get hit by a Sturmpanzer II, you know, 150mm HE shell, and also the T-14, I guess. Yeah, you can survive it, and that's the strength of the Matilda. It's not a walkover tank. But before I talk about the armor, if somebody has a clear shot on you, especially tanks at your battle rating, like the Panzer IV tanks, then you are in trouble. But if they just don't aim properly, rush the shot, and just hit one of your angled surfaces or thick armor parts, they can bounce and your return shots will just simply do the job. So let's have a look at the armor and the interior.
The armor of this vehicle is quite interesting. We have 75mm on many places, and this middle bar here is rather flat, so it's kind of a weak spot.
This 55mm is additional armor as far as I can see, and there are a few steps here. This bar here is angled, so we have 90mm. This step here is 47mm, but heavily angled. And depending on the exact angle, it's nearly 100mm thick. We have another 78mm here on the front, also a little bit angled. You know, it's a bit part of the lower glacis. And yeah, we also have a little bit of the bottom armor, so to speak, with 22mm. That's an actual weak spot. And this also seems to be like a weak spot, but that's not actually part of the interior. So if you penetrate this, you do not really actually do damage to the interior of the tank. Then we also can see this 20mm, it's very steeply angled, but it can get overmatched, so don't, you know, trust it too much. We also have this plating here. Again, very dubious story. The side of the tank is also very interesting, 70mm at a bit of an angle on this top bar here. Then we have this spaced armor, 25mm. Additionally, this, also spaced armor part here. Above the tracks, you can see that it is just under the tracks. And behind that, you can see it here at the bottom. 40mm, so it's 65mm of side armor, and that's quite amazing. Now you might think, yeah, angle the hull like on a Tiger or a KV-1. Don't do this, you will expose this bar here and that will make it flat.
this part here will be stronger, this part here will be also pretty strong, depending at the right angle, and then this part here is exposed. So it's a bit like on the Ferdinand or the Panzerbefehlswagen 6P or the VK for 502. Then the rear of the tank, 55 millimeters, but this top here is just 20 millimeters. Also 20 millimeters is the deck armor, and the armor on top of the turret is just 18 millimeters. Then the turret is the turret itself is 75 millimeters all around, rounded, so that's quite something, to be honest. So you're mostly triple A safe. And then we also have this modified turret front. Now you can see that we have a little bit of angling going on. This is also very rounded, 75 millimeters, and this gun mantle here as well, 75 millimeters, as well as the cupola. The interesting part is that this, gun holding here is actually the weak spot. So it looks like, you know, one of those areas where a shot might disappear, but just shoot here, it's a rather prominent target, and you can penetrate here. And that will hurt the tank. Why? Because you have four crew members, of which three are located in the turret, namely the loader on the left hand side, together with the gunner and the commander on the right hand side, with the driver being in the middle. Also, we see a lot of ammunition here on those side racks and so on, and they will get emptied first before this ammunition rack gets used. And those are, if I'm not mistaken, 24 rounds that you have to remove, or 23, because one shell is already being registered as loaded in the breech, which is a rather big target by itself. And you know, if you lose two crew members, you have a rather long reload, together with the fuel tanks, the transmission, and the engine in the back. So the battle that you just saw in the background was actually my very first battle, and immediately I had an ace. Now, you know, your first game is always a statistical oddity. Maybe you just get into the right position, or you have an awful game and everything was against you. But again, the kind of combination of a Soviet gun and British, let's say heavy tank armor is quite successful, and it just does the job. Now you can see here the results for a tier 2 premium tank, 50,000 silver lines for 5 kills. That's quite something, I'd say. I personally love the tank, but you don't really, you know, get the feel in this just literally run through what this battle was. So I think it's time that we have a look at another battle. And the battle that I show you now is here on Poland, and it will be a nice battle, I have to say. Now, nice battles are, you know, per definition, not the worst, but not the most outstanding ones. People might also say, yeah, you're just seal clubbing at the low battle rating, but hey, I'm just showcasing the tank, it's purely for science. Yeah. So I'm just going straight in, and you can see me here in the beginning actually do something very stupid. Just go in and see what's happening, you know, and just deal with the situations that occur. Now I have to say, first of all, I'm sorry about the sound quality if it is worse than usual, and it actually this tank video is actually an interruption of my self-made schedule, so to speak. I totally overlooked this M8 here, and I just rushed it out. I got those vehicles, the here the Matilda 2 and also one plane from Gaijin, because I just simply had no time to play the events, the Cronicles events, but I have played very similar events often enough, and also the last year Chronicles. I know that they are very, very time intense and also very frustrating, especially if you don't team up. You need to have team members and try to work down all the tasks one by one with teamwork, and you know what you need, and you also want to work for your team members, and then that's the one of the fastest ways. Now the simple question is this vehicle worth the effort, time, and potentially money? I say it depends. Again, first of all, it's a collector's item. Then it's a low tier premium vehicle, so keep that in mind. You will not research your T10M any faster by driving this one. But overall, in terms of firepower, it teaches you quite a bit for that battle rating. The first and second T-34s and also the first KV-1 have very similar firepower. Now you can see me here, you know, having a lot of shells selected, and you know, let's just talk a moment about the ammunition. Now this F-96 gun has quite some interesting ammunition choice. First of all, the sheer amount of shells is quite something, 5 different shells, and we see some of the very same. The first one is the BR-350A with the MD5 fuse. Why is that important? First of all, it has 150 grams of TNT filling for an APHEBC shell. That is highly effective. The fuse sensitivity is just 10 millimeters, but the fuse delay is just 15 centimeters. That means the damage effect is, after penetration, more like hash. But, you know, it's quite a very strong shell. Then we also have the BR-350SP, which is a simple solid shot. It's an APBC shell with 105 millimeters of penetration. But, you know, after having such a good, rather stock round, I would not really use it. Maybe for some really heavily armored targets, like probably Churchill Mark 3s. You know, always maybe have some of those shells with you. But then we come to the BR-350B shell. And it has more penetration than the BR-350A. It has 98 millimeters of initial penetration, in comparison to the 80 millimeters of the first one, and it has the MD8 fuse. That means, in effect, it has a TNT equivalent of 108.8 grams. That is the very same TNT equivalent as on the German Long 88 APHE shell. Now, what is the real difference in performance? Well, the fuse sensitivity is higher, 15 millimeters, but you still will always trigger the shell, basically. Very few exceptions, mostly the lightly armored vehicles, such as AAA vehicles. The fuse delay, on the other hand, is nearly a meter, so the damage effect gets carried much deeper into the enemy tank. So I would mostly like to use this one, higher penetration and basically the same damaging effect. Then we have the HE shell, 9 millimeters. Not the most useful thing to have, but you lack the heavy machine gun, so maybe a few rounds. And then there's the SH-354T shrapnel shell. TNT is 85 grams, but, you know, as the name says, it creates huge amounts of very big shrapnels. The penetration, though, just 37 millimeters. I've used it sometimes when hunting AAA vehicles. The fun part was that against AAA vehicles, it's not extremely efficient like a hash shell on higher tier vehicles, but it still does the job. And surprisingly enough, you can penetrate, even with 35 millimeters of penetration, a lot of tanks at certain places, or especially from the side, and that shell just simply kills. So it's very nice to have this shell also with you. It's a rather unique shell. I tried around a little bit with it. So my actual ammunition loadout that you can see me here in the battle is not recommended. I was just trying around and killing stuff. Yeah. So that's my ace so far. Now you can see me here repairing. I did not lose any crew member, just the engine is slightly yellow. Now it's repaired. And again, I move around. You can see the disastrous mobility and maneuverability aspect of this tank. It takes ages. This is not a medium tank. This behaves more like a mouse, mobility-wise. And, you know, at certain points the mouse just says, boy, get some mobility, man. That's awful. And, you know, when a mouse says that to you, you're either a Matilda or a T-95. So, yeah. This vehicle is not really fast. I have to say it. And mobility is not the key aspect. It's more like a rolling bunker. And in this respect, now we have to come around to compare it to certain other vehicles at its battle rating. First of all, the first T-34. Or also the second one to which it has the gun in common. Not from the name, but ammunition selection wise. The T-34 is much more mobile and also has rather trollish armor for its battle rating. And then there is the KV-1 with the L-11 gun. Basically the same gun in its effect overall, but you can angle the armor. The armor itself is in most parts comparable in thickness, but it, you know, is also rather flat in comparison. However, you can angle it on the KV-1, which you can't on the Matilda. So the Matilda is by no means overpowered, especially when we look at the rest of the Soviet tech tree at that battle rating. But it is a nice tank to have. The side armor is quite trollish sometimes, and you should not underestimate it. Now, here I am capturing the zone, and so on and so on. So, yeah, you can see by the commentary and by the just gameplay that you can see in the background, the tactic is simple. Just go for the objective or try to reach the front line as fast as possible. Just murder the enemy team by shooting them in the face. Most likely you get one shots. But please take just one-on-one. So, you know, don't let your common game sense get lost in the, you know, bloodbath that you create. I have to say, the tank has a very simple playstyle. And again, as I said in the tank review part, so to speak, don't angle the armor. I know it, you know, seems promising to do so, but then there's this one part that is unangled and it is below the turret. And many people just simply shoot there and then they will kill you. So again, the armor is trollish, lots of angles, lot of bouncing zones, a few additional armor parts. But it's not that the armor is impenetrable. So it's always a gamble. And, you know, I think that the T-34 and also the KV-1 make this game, or play the game better, you know, of gambling the armor, Russian roulette, so to speak. I have no real words for describing it, but, you know, when an enemy just comes around the corner and just shoots at you, either he misses you or he hits you. And when he hits, it's very likely that he hits a part that is heavily angled or sloped or, you know, just not penetratable for that gun. The arch nemesis of this tank is the German Panzer IV from the F2 onwards, because they have the very powerful 75mm medium length barrel. It's not long barrel 75 because that's on the Panther, but you know what I'm going for. So, to be honest, this tank does not act very well or doesn't perform very well in an up tier. And its own battle rating, it can really hold itself, and put into the right circumstances with the right situations, it might seem like an impenetrable front. Again, this is a collector's item in the first case for me personally, but it's not a bad vehicle. But it's also not, you know, the overpowered Russian bias, lend-lease, magic weapon system that certain people wanted it to be or expected it to be. It's a tank that is very simple. It's a tank that works. It's a tank that kills. But as you can see, one of the frustrating parts, again, is the mobility. And it's just so frustrating to just see things happening on the minimap and you can't react in time, even on rather small maps. I have to say, city maps are something that this tank prefers, because then the lack of gun depression is not really that critical, I'd say. You play mostly on flat terrain. I reverse angle here. At that point, I did not really watch, kind of. I have no idea where this shot went. I have really no idea where this shot went. You see me having here a ping of 21. If Gaijin wants a better ping from me, I'm sorry, guys. I can't deliver better. I'm sorry. So now you can see me here loading a shrapnel shell. And let's just have a look at the effect. So I saw a locust going partially for me. I shot at him, the shell disappeared, and then there was also this triple A vehicle. And now I just tried to flank them a little bit. And I saw the shadow and shoot him in the face. And you can see here in the hit cam, that was quite a brutal hit. That was quite a brutal hit. The TNT equivalent is kind of deceiving, because many people think that this shell works like an APHE shell. Basically, yes, but the damage effect comes more from the shrapnel filling, which is not displayed. I have not really any idea how Gaijin implements it. Again, I see the shadow and I hear the engine of the AAA vehicle. And yeah, I just kill him for my 8th kill. And now I try to get again into the capture zone that I captured like 2 minutes ago. And you know, did just a drive around in the city. But before I could capture it, the tickets went down and yeah, we won the game. So again, a very nice battle for me. And again, once the results come in, just have a look at the post-battle results. So again, here talking about the results for the 8 kills and numerous other actions like 2 zones captured, I got 71,000 silver lines and nearly 5,800 research points. That's actually a pretty good income for a low tier premium. Now that's it for me today. I hope you enjoyed this preview / semi tank review. And do I recommend this vehicle as a collector's item? Yes. As a proper grinding machine? Well, you have to learn how to drive it and you need to be very patient with it. So that's it for me today. Let me know in the comment section what you think about this vehicle and if you think it's worth the effort, and if you got your hands on it, do you regret it? Do you think it's awesome? Let me know. That's it for me today. So thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. Please give this video a like if you did, subscribe if you want to see more, and we'll see each other on the battlefields of War Thunder.